All right, in chapter 6 of Muggy Maggie, I asked you what makes Maggie realize she cannot read cursive and what made her suddenly think cursive handwriting was interesting. Connor said the right answer. She realized when Miss Leaper calls on her to read the board, and also she found it interesting suddenly because she wanted to be able to read those notes that were passed between Miss Leaper and the principal, Mr. Klutz. She knew that it was something to do with her because of what? Her name was in the notes. She could read that, but she could not read the cursive, so now she wants to learn. Let's find out in chapter 7. For the next few days, Maggie was a busy message monitor because Mrs. Leaper sent her hurrying to one room after another. She was even sent to the library. The envelope grew shabby. Most messages contained her name, others did not. Maggie snatched moments in the hall to try to figure out words, but all she learned was that some teachers were careless about joining letters without lifting pencils from paper. "How come you're delivering so many messages?" asked Kirby. "Because she can't read cursive," said Courtney. "And Mrs. Leaper knows she can't snoop," said Kelly. "Mrs. Leaper wants me to deliver them," said Maggie. "It makes her happy."
"I bet," said Kirby.
On her way to the first grade room, Maggie discovered that all of Mrs. Leaper's notes looked exactly alike, which was funny. Peculiar, not funny. Ha ha. Feeling big and important in front of first graders, Maggie wondered about this, and she listened to the little children play with the Velcro fasteners on their shoes. Rip, rip, rip. This teacher's answer to Mrs. Leaper did not contain her name. So Maggie was not much interested. It read, "Keep it up. You will wear this kid down yet." In the sixth grade room, Maggie felt as if she had shrunk because all the sixth graders stared at her while the teacher, a tall man with a ferocious beard, read the note. "There's the cootie," she heard a boy whisper. Maggie tossed her hair. The class teetered. Maggie wondered whether the boys called their teacher's beard a cootie motel. The man glanced at Maggie, grinning, and wrote a note on the back of an old spelling test. Then he crossed out his name on the ragged envelope, replaced it with Mrs. Leaper's name in one of the few spaces left, and handed it to Maggie, who was grateful to escape to the hall. When she peeked, Maggie found her own name just as she had in other notes, but this time she found it twice. The note read, "I once had a bright kid like Maggie who thought she couldn't read cursive. She really could when she tried, but she wouldn't. Sounds like Maggie." Maggie, desperate to read, discovered this teacher was careless about joining letters. If she had time, maybe she could puzzle them out, but she knew that she was expected back in her own classroom. Sending someone to find her would not make Mrs. Leaper happy. Friday evening, Joanne telephoned to ask Maggie to spend the night at her house. Maggie said she couldn't. Joanne wanted to know why. Maggie said she had to help her father. "I thought he did some kind of office work," said Joanne. "He does," said Maggie, thinking fast. "I know how to use our computer." She had not lied. Not exactly, but she felt guilty. That weekend, Maggie studied every bit of cursive writing she could find. Her mother's tipping over backward grocery list, Ms. Madden's neat handwritten notes mixed in with papers her father brought home from the office. Anything. She did not try to read her father's writing. She knew it was hopeless. Why? Probably because her father's handwriting is too messy. Some people's cursive handwriting is too messy to figure out. Maggie spent most of her time in her room with her door closed. With Kaiser's nose resting on her foot and some old paper, work papers in front of her, She frantically practiced cursive, including the difficult capitals like Q, W, and F. "What are you doing, Maggie?" asked her mother through the door. "Nothing," answered Maggie, aware that her mother felt children were entitled to privacy and would not open the door. Letting her parents know she had changed her mind would make Maggie feel ashamed, like admitting she had been wrong. Maggie worked hard, and by Sunday evening she agreed with what Mrs. Leeper had been saying all along. Many cursive letters are shaped like printed letters. She knew she could read cursive as long as it was neat. She practiced her signature with her letters leaning into the wind. Maggie Schultz, Maggie Schultz. When she finished, Maggie's face was flushed, her hair more tousled than usual, but she could write cursive. Maybe it wasn't perfect, but anyone past the second grade could read it. She went to her father, who was working at the computer. "Daddy, listen to me," she said, and her voice was stern. Mr. Schultz turned from the keyboard. "Okay, Maggie, what's up?" "In writing, neatness counts," Maggie informed him. "I expect it does," he agreed. "Then you should learn to close your loops and put the right numbers of peaks on your U's and write neatly," said Maggie. "Funny, Miss Madden says the same thing," said Mr. Schultz. "I'll try, cross my heart." Maggie was not sure she believed him. Next, Maggie went to her mother and announced, "You should make your writing lean the other way, like it's supposed to, and stop putting silly circles over your eyes." Mrs. Schultz smiled and pushed Maggie's hair back from her flushed face. "I don't know about that angel face," she said. "Everyone says my handwriting is distinguished." Maggie was tired and cross. "Well, it's wrong," she said, and she sighed so hard that Kaiser looked anxious. Grown-ups were so hard to reform, maybe impossible. So it sounds to me like Maggie likes to write cursive handwriting now because she can. We'll find out what happens in the next chapter. Do you think she'll be able to know cursive good enough where she'll be able to read when she's messenger? We'll find out.